praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, thy the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy the glory. Revive us.
Welcome to Reconciled 521/FBC podcast and Facebook platform. You are with me, your host, Gideon Mpeni. It is such a blessing and a joy to once again be with you this morning, even as we ponder on issues pertaining to what is happening in the church and what is happening in the world around us. And what we are going to be looking at this week, we are going to be speaking about revival. We began last week speaking about this topic, looking at what revival is and what revival is not. But what I want us to examine this day, you are there and you cannot deny the fact that we are living in such a time when everything seems as though it's not going as it should be. We are living in such a time when there are four key major trends that we are seeing. If we look and we examine them from a biblical perspective, there seem to be darkness amongst the nations, when nations have given themselves over to the evil one. That there seems to be a complete denial, a complete disregard of the things of God in our land. Whatsoever you might be, it's not only the pandemic right now that we as a nation are facing. It's not only the COVID-19 that has afflicted us at this time, but there seems to be a decay of religious faith. There seems to be people, as Paul would describe in 2 Timothy chapter 3, that in the last days perilous times shall come, men shall have a form of godliness, yet they deny the power thereof. There seems to be a decay. There seems to be a disregard of the things of God. There seems to be a lack of zeal for God himself, that men and women are going about their own business, that even in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of this tossed ship that we are all in, people seems to be indifferent. There is the third thing that I want to point out. There's deadness of the churches. In the West, some churches have closed, and there seems to be, even with this COVID now, we have more than ever seen as to how many have claimed to have a faith, but yet it is in time of trial, even as the Lord Jesus Christ had put it in the book of Matthew chapter 7, those who hear these sayings of mine and does them, they are the ones who stand when the trials of this life would hit. But there is a falling away. Many who are going after the world, you cannot distinguish between the world and the church in the day and in the age that we're living in. And the fourth thing that I want you to remember, that we have seen prevalent and we've seen it growing in the Church of Jesus Christ, not only on the soils of Africa, but also in the world at large. We've seen deception prevailing in the land. We've seen the rise of false prophets in our land. All these four things, darkness in the nations, the decay of religion, religious faith, the deadness of the churches, deception in our land. When we see the rise of these false prophets who are coming in, and they're just coming in for their own dummies and their own good. All these, brothers and sisters, cause for us to realize that more than ever, we need a revival. G. Campbell Morgan, who said this, and I quote, it is ever the darkest hour before the dawn. The nations always seems to be given over to the evil one before the Son of Man comes. The decay of religious faith, the deadness of the churches, the atheism of the well-to-do, and the brutality of the masses. When all these are at their worst, they call for revival. But then what I want us to examine this day is, who is it that must take a center stage or a front seat when we desire a revival? What is the characteristic that we need? What is the lifestyle that must be lived out if we are to be a people that the Lord would work among us and the Lord would move among us? Because the true Holy Spirit revival is a remarkable increase in the spiritual life of a large number of God's people. Brian Edwards would say this kind of a remarkable increase in the spiritual life of a large number of God's people, it is accompanied by an awesome awareness of the presence of sin with a passionate longing for holiness. An unusual effectiveness in evangelism leading to the salvation of many unbelievers. That's what must happen in revival. That's what must take place in revival. And as we examine the scriptures, which we are going to today, we are going to see as to how God describes himself and how fundamental is holiness in revival. So we are going to see how holiness is the key lifestyle, is the key cry that must be present among us, God's people. We cannot talk of revival if we are not living a holy life. So then turn with me, and we're going to read together from the book of Isaiah chapter 57, and we're going to see in Isaiah 57, as we see from verse 14 of Isaiah all the way to verse 16. Listen to what the Lord God says in Isaiah chapter 14. God says in his word, and he shall be said, build up, build up. Remove every obstruction from my people's ways. For thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in their high and holy place, and also with him who is of a contrite and a lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly, and to revive the heart of the contrite. For I will not contend forever, nor I will always be angry. For the spirit would grow faint before me, and the breath of life that I made. Listen to verse 17. God says in his word, because of iniquity of his unjust gain, I was angry. I struck him, I hid my face, and I was angry. But he went on backsliding in the way of his own heart. I have seen his ways, but I will heal him. I will heal him, and I will restore comfort to him and his mourners, creating the fruit of the lips, peace, peace to the far and to the near, says the Lord. And I will heal him, says the Lord God. Let's just pray before we would just even look at this passage and we challenge one another as to why holiness is key and is fundamental when it comes to revival. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we pray and we ask of you that you be with us. Goddess and O Lord, we cry before you that you will heal us. Heal us of our backslidings. Heal our land. Heal our hearts. Above all else, Father, I pray for the leaders of your church. Pray, Father God, that you begin with us. You will, oh Father, awaken us and you will consecrate us, that we too will come to the place where we realize and we acknowledge of our own sinfulness. We will see how holy and how righteous you are, and yet we acknowledge and we will realize of our own sinfulness. It is for the glory of your name we ask, and may God's people say amen. So as we come to this passage, and as we reflect to the fundamental aspect of when we speak about revival, we need to realize that holiness plays a fundamental key and role in the life of a believer. We are not speaking about just meetings. We are not speaking about just organizing a crusade somewhere else. Neither are we just talking about some emotionalism. We are speaking about being saturated with God. We are speaking about a remarkable increase in the spiritual life of a large number of God's people that is accompanied by an awesome awareness of the presence of sin. Look at that. There must be an awesome awareness of the presence of sin. In other words, as we come face to face with a holy God, we must come to that place like Isaiah, where he would acknowledge in Isaiah chapter 6. You remember? Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah would come face to face with the holy God, and Isaiah would stand, and as you heard the angels singing and shouting, "Holy, holy is the Lord, God Almighty." Isaiah beholds the glory of God, that it is awesome. Isaiah beholds the holiness of God, that God is holy in his majesty, in his holiness. And as you see in this verse of Isaiah 57, we see something that God is saying about himself. Isaiah says, as he accounts and as he records and as he recalls that vision he saw in chapter 6, "For thus says the one who is high and lifted up." Isaiah has that image. He has that vision in view here as he speaks in verse 15. He's the one who inhabits in eternity, whose name is holy. So Isaiah is really very aware of what God and who God is. Isaiah is aware of who God is as he recounts of that chapter 6 account, as he recounts of who this mighty one is. And brothers and sisters, it is with that in mind that we do acknowledge the holiness of God. And when it comes to revival, we cannot speak of revival if we do not admit and if we do not come to be aware of this God who is holy. What is holiness then? What do we mean when we say holiness? Because if this God is the one who is high, if we speak of revival, we are speaking of having this awareness of sin. I want you to remember what Isaiah did as he saw that holiness of God. He then would say, "Woe is me, for I am done. I'm a man of unclean lips because I dwell among a people of unclean lips." So then there's this great need amongst us, and this begins with us who are leaders. Yes, we can look at the world around us and we see darkness in the world. We see a decay of religious faith. We see a deadness of the churches. Yes, we are seeing deception around us. Yes, we are seeing all those things around us. But when we speak of revival, revival must begin with you and me. It must begin here. We must come to this realization of the holiness of God. And then what that and how that will look like, we must be those men. Those men who have the habit of being of one mind with God, as J.C. Ryle would say it. Holiness, Jeremiah described it in this way, that holiness is the habit of being of one mind with God, according as we find his mind described in the scripture. It is the habit of agreeing in God's judgment, hating what he hates. That's what holiness is. Loving what he loves, and measuring everything in this world by the standard of his word. He who most entirely agrees with God, he is most holy man. Are we like that? Because that's what we need right now. That's something that is pertinent. This is something that we need at this particular hour. We need to be holy men. Men who endeavor to shun every known sin and to keep every known commandment. That's the kind of men we need. If we are to be men who are going to be saturated with God, we must be the kind of men who have a resolved bent of mind toward God. We must have a hearty desire to do his will. We must have a greater fear of displeasing him than of displeasing the world. That's what we need in this hour, don't we? We need that kind of a mindset. We need the mindset that will say, Lord, we want all of you and less of us. And we see it revealed in the Bible. Holiness can never be separated from revival. If some kind of spiritual experience in an individual or among a community has the label of revival pinned to it, you know what we need to be looking for? Brian Edwards will say this. If ever we want to see and we want to term anything to be a revival, we want to see what is the lives of men in that community like. How are we living our lives? That's very crucial. If we are to see a great move of God, if we are to see God working among us, if we want to see God working in us, even in this time of lockdown, as we are faced with this pandemic, we must have a great sense of his holiness. We must long to be holy in this hour. If men would claim to be moving and to be walking in this moment of revival, we need to ask this question. Are they walking in holiness? Are they a holy people who fear God only and sin? Are they allowing God's word to rule in their hearts? If not, we are not looking at revival. Neither, we're not just talking about loud excitements. We are not only even just talking about somber quietness. We are not just talking about love and gifts. No, we are not talking about just spiritual gifts manifesting. No, that's not what we are talking about. We are not talking about the kind of the crazy charismania. That's not what we are talking about. The necessary evidence of any revival, it is known most of the men who have experienced revival, even as we see it revealed in the Bible, there must be a deep conviction of sin. And there must be a biblical kind of holiness. Because God prefers light more than he prefers heat. God prefers holiness more than he prefers happiness. And that's what we need, brothers and sisters. There must be a great sense of the holiness of God. That we hate and we separate ourselves from the world. And we separate ourselves from the things that we love most. And we submit ourselves to God. And that is what we need in this hour more than ever. But if the Lord is going to do that among us, as you see it in the Bible, whenever God would do that, Do you know who God begins with, and do you know who it must start with? It's crucial for us to take this. It's crucial for us to grasp this. And I'm speaking to myself here. It starts with us who are on the forefront of leading God's people. We must have that realization of our own sinfulness. And we must come to that place when we know and admit that God hates sin, and that sin is the sin that is locking, and it is a sin that is deep within our hearts. There must be that deep conviction of sin, and we must yearn after a biblical holiness. So then, if you check in your Bible, in 2 Chronicles we are told, of one man in 2 Chronicles, Hezekiah. He was a leader of his people, and as such, Hezekiah would come to his people, and I want you to know this, that Hezekiah would come to his people, and he would be the one to begin this process, as he came with one intent, to see the worship of God restored among his people. And it was a priest of God. Hezekiah would come in 2 Chronicles chapter 29, in the first year of his reign, in the first month, he opened the doors of the house of the Lord, and he repaired them. The Bible tells us he brought the priests together, the Levites. He assembled them in the square, and he caused them. He shows them the need for consecration. And he told them, "Hear me, O Levites, consecrate yourself and consecrate the house of the Lord God. Carry out all the filth from the holy place." And he would recount the backslidings of the people, the cause why this was a holy place, but yet the people of God had desecrated it. They had messed it up. They had made this place as a place where sin would dwell. And the first thing that Hezekiah would do is, he would call the priest to come in. In 2 Chronicles 29, look at that chapter. He will call the priest to come, and he will tell the priest to say they needed to consecrate themselves first. They needed to consecrate the place where God would dwell. And he said to them, consecrate the house of the Lord, the God of your fathers, and carry out the filth from the holy place. Why? In verse number 6, Hezekiah would tell the people to say, for our fathers have been unfaithful, and they have done what was evil in the sight of the Lord our God. They have forsaken him, and they have turned away from their faces from the habitation of the Lord, and they have turned their backs. So then, if we speak about this revival, and if we speak about this move of God, if we're speaking about holiness, I am not speaking about, yes, holiness in the streets. That's what we desire. We desire holiness in the nation. Yes, that's what we long for. We desire holiness in our governments. Yes, that's what we long for. But no, church, this call, first and foremost, must begin with the men who are forefront. We are speaking of the pastors here. We are speaking of the church leaders. We are speaking of the deacons. We are speaking of the elders of the different churches. We must consecrate ourselves, because our God is a holy God. We need to carry out, we need to remove all the filth, just like these people we are called to. They were called to carry out, to consecrate even the place where God would dwell. We don't talk about temples right now. Maybe even churches have been closed, but we know in the New Testament that when we speak about temples, we are speaking about ourselves, our lives, our bodies, our temples of the Holy Spirit. And Paul would call Timothy to say, but you man of God, watch your life and your doctrine closely. And this is what we are speaking about here. When we speak about holiness, we are speaking about that life that has been devoted, consecrated unto the Lord. We are speaking about the man and not the movement. We are speaking about the missionary before we talk about the mission. We are speaking about the minister before we speak about the ministry. So the consecration that we need the consecration of the men before we speak about the mission itself. And that's what we need. Failure, which, because as you see in 2 Chronicles, because these people did not follow after God. the Lord would call them. The wrath of the Lord came on Judah and Jerusalem, and he made them an object of horror, of astonishment, and of hissing. As they see, as you see with your own eyes, God who speaks through Isaiah. For behold, our fathers, they are fallen by the sword, and our sons and our daughters and our wives, they are carried into captivity. Because Israel did not obey God. In 2 Chronicles chapter 29, as you see there, God will speak through Hezekiah. And Hezekiah would tell the people to say, consecrate yourself. Because what the forefathers had done, they shut down the doors of the vestibules. They put out the lamps. They did not burn incense and offered burnt offerings to the Lord. And we're going to speak about this tomorrow, prayerlessness. But the key aspect there, it's holiness. They walked in unholiness before the Lord their God. Therefore, brothers and sisters, when these high priests, when these priests came, and they realized what Hezekiah was saying when he was calling them to consecrate themselves and to consecrate the temple. They went into the temple and they cleansed the temple. Second Chronicles chapter 29 from verse 15 to 16. They thoroughly cleaned the temple, even in places where the places that were hidden. It was easier that as they came to the temple, they would have even maybe come in and do something that was just haphazard. But they were able to go into the temple and into the parts of the temple which were even furthest from the eyes of men. They cleaned them. They made sure that those places were clean. They could have just maybe overlooked this and a few would have maybe seen it. The priest could have maybe even shoveled away all the dirt from the outer court and they swept it spotlessly around the great altar outside. They could have even maybe emptied the stagnant water in the great baths in front of the altar, and they would have maybe just filled it with fresh water. It was possible for them to do that. They would have just done something that was impressive in the outside, and they would have just done nothing concerning what was expected of them. But you know what this priest did? They went into the sanctuary, studied there. They went into the furthest places where eyes of men could not see, because they realized and they knew that God judges the secrets of men. And I want you to know this. When we're speaking about holiness here, we are not speaking about just what we are seeing around us. When we are speaking about revival, we are not just speaking about revival that we need some extra extra experiences around us. Or we are not just looking at man glorifying himself. At heart, what do we need is holiness. And holiness begins with an alarm at the sin that is locking in the dark corners of our lives. Like Isaiah would come before God and he would see God high and holy, lifted up. And this is this God who is saying, I dwell in the high and the holy place. And also with him who is of a contrite and of a lowly spirit. What is he coming to do? To revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. Isaiah is very much aware as he says these words that this God who dwells in the high and the holy does not look at sin. He is the one who hates sin. And Paul never encouraged his readers, Mary, to make promise to God. But he always, if you check even in the New Testament, Paul would urge his leaders to take action. He writes in a blunt way to the Christians in Rome when he says in chapter 6 of Romans, verse 13, don't offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. This is what I'm talking about, brothers and sisters. And when you look at what Jesus Christ says in the book of Matthew chapter 5, blessed are those who mourn. It refers to those who feel their sin and they cry over it. Because sin is always a problem to the Christian who is longing for revival. And revival always deals uncomfortably with those things the world around us does not see. Revival throws light in the dark places. Revival is always a revival of holiness. It begins with the terrible conviction of sin. It is often the form that is, this conviction of sin takes the trouble those who read of revival. Sometimes the experience of crushing. People weep uncontrollably, and worse, they come to the place where they cry out with Isaiah, "Woe is me, for I am done. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Because if we speak about revival, brothers and sisters, there is no such a thing as a revival without tears of conviction and sorrow. There has to be, and there must be, sorrow within us. Revival does not persuade the world that the Christian faith is fun, but that it is essential. Because the first work of the Spirit is not to tell us that we can be happy. The first work of the Spirit is to tell us that we must be holy. The Holy Spirit has come to convict the world, firstly, of righteousness, secondly, of sin, thirdly, of the judgment to come. That's why the Holy Spirit comes. That's why we need a people saturated with God, a people who can come to the realization, to the awakening that, Lord, we need the move of your Spirit. So that kind of the people would come to the place where they see the holiness of God as the scales from their eyes are lifted up, as the veil from their faces is lifted up, and they gaze and they behold the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. When we do that as Christians, then we are going to hate sin. The non-believers would behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the whole world. The kind of men God has used in revival were men who trembled at sin, whose conscience was sensitive to the approach of sin, men who did not try to justify their laziness, men who did not try to justify their careless habits, but these were men who lived a disciplined and determined life. And if there is one thing common to the men God uses in revival, it is that they are men who fear nothing but God and sin. So the reason for this is that revival is always a revival of holiness. And therefore, the vessels that God uses must be holy, for God is holy. So then may I make this appeal to the leaders of the church. The Bible says, so goes the priest, so goes the people. As the leaders are, so are the people. So there is no honor to God in an unhappy people. When we look at the fruits of revival, we see how great a reformation and a revival brings to a society. But the reason for deep conviction is so that the people will feel their sin and hate it. So we need... we need a revival. We need revival. In light of this, how many of us are ready for revival? Have we shown God that we want a revival? Have we come to the place where we've come like Isaiah to see his holiness? And as we behold his holiness, we see our sin. And we can say with Isaiah, "Woe is me, for I am done." But Isaiah 57, brothers and sisters, God makes his promise. Verse 14 and 15, and I finish. "And he shall be said, build up, build up. Remove every obstruction from my people's ways. For thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and the holy place. And also with him who is of the contrite and lowly spirit, for this purpose, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. May we long for revival. May we walk in this week knowing that holiness is one and the fundamental trait that we need as Christians if we desire to see revival among us. What does that mean? Simple words. It means that we will be men who will have a habit of being one mind with God. It is the habit of agreeing in God's judgments, hating what he hates, loving what he loves, and measuring everything in this world by the standard of his word. We agree with God that he is a holy God, and we desire to be holy as he is holy. May the Lord God bless you today and in this week. As we will meet again tomorrow, just going on another necessity to this issue of revival. So we need holiness in revival. Holiness is primary. We need to walk holy, to live holy if we want to see God moving. But tomorrow, join us as we'll be looking at prayer as a necessity and a precursor to any revival. Let's bow our heads and we pray. Our Father, we thank you and we honor you for your word. We ask of you in this day that you will, O God Almighty, work in us. If there are some who are listening to this and they are not saved, Lord, we ask of you that you would work in their hearts. You will show them who you are, that you will show us our own sinfulness, and you show us your glorious riches in Christ, that we may come there and find, above all else, not just a revival, that they will find a regeneration, that they will find an awakening, that you would, O God, cause us to come before you and acknowledge your glorious grace in Christ Jesus. It is for the glory and honor of your name and for the good of your church we ask of this. May God's people say amen. Thank you very much. You are with me, Gideon Mpeni, and it was a joy and a blessing to share God's word with you. See you again, God willing, tomorrow. Thank you.
Play one, Matthew.
Sing hallelujah, thy Lord glory, hallelujah, amen, hallelujah, thy Lord glory, revive us again,
revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above.
Hallelujah.